to get ourselves to a point to discuss Heber C. Kimball's mission to England and the successes he had as a missionary and his companions that were with him, doubled the membership of the church, which is fascinating to me to think about. I think in a lot of ways we are in a similar time, because while Heber C. Kimball is in England and these British saints are joining the church and becoming lifelong members, as many of our ancestors maybe were included in this batch, Kirtland is going through a state of apostasy. Even members of the 12 in Kirtland, with two exceptions, only Brigham Young and Heber C. Kimball remained absolutely and devotedly loyal to Joseph Smith. Perhaps one of the more interesting of this company. And just so we can see where people were, and also I'd like to thank Josie for getting the Elder Rasband fixed. I'm going to hang these with nails so they don't keep Velcro slipping off. But this is where Brigham Young would have sat, and this is where Heber C. Kimball would have sat, and this is where Parley P. Pratt would have sat. Just for your interest, to see where these young apostles kind of were spread out in their responsibilities and their seniority. So Heber C. or Parley P. Pratt is home in April 1836. And his wife, Thankful, has been ill their whole life. She's had a chronic health problem, has been described as being very delicate of health. She had severe spells of sick headache, which came upon her monthly. She was frail. She probably had mental health issues as well. There's a couple articles that I saw about describing her situation as depressed. But see, that's a hard thing, is that we read the word depressed and we think about depression. But in 1830, I don't know, she may have just had low spirits. But we also know that mental health issues just weren't treated when people didn't know what they were. Thankful Pratt, that's her name, Thankful, which is beautiful. Thankful Pratt had been of poor health, and Heber C. Kimball just shows up at Parley's house just on the west side of Kirtland, and blesses him. "Brother Parley, thy wife shall be healed from this hour." How about that? Now, she never recovered full health. She didn't become 100%, but she was healthy enough that the second prophecy, that she would bear a son, and his name shall be called Parley. He shall be a chosen instrument in the hands of the Lord to inherit the priesthood. Thankful and Parley had been married for 9 years, without children, and Thankful was on the far side of that. She was 10 years older than Parley when they got married in the first place, and you know. But she does conceive, and in March 1837, their son Parley P. Pratt Jr. is born. Parley Pratt Jr. will become a great missionary. Not quite the missionary of his father's stature, but he will serve 5 different missions, and including being a mission president in the southern states, and just a great man of the Restoration. The second part of the promise was, "Thou shalt go to Upper Canada, even to the city of Toronto, the capital." I don't know why they called that Upper Canada, because it was it's the bottom part of Canada, but I guess it was upper to America. I don't know. "Go to Toronto, the capital, and there thou shalt find a people prepared for the fullness of the gospel, and they shall receive thee, and thou shalt organize the church among them, and it shall spread thence into the regions round about." Of the converts, there were many converts, Parley P. Pratt creates a church, a ward, a district in Toronto. And among the converts are John and Lenora Taylor, Mary Fielding, Joseph Fielding, and Mercy Rachel Fielding. Those names are significant to us in our church history. We know them and we love them. I lead off with John Taylor, who then after he joins the church, and he doesn't just join the church like so many did, hearing the message one time and falling in love with it. He'd been a Methodist preacher, and he took his Bible and followed Parley P. Pratt around to Elder Pratt's preaching opportunities, and he fact-checked him wherever he went with his Bible, and then finding that everything that Elder Pratt taught of the restoration was biblically sound, John decides to join the church, and he is almost at the same time of his confirmation, he's ordained to the Melchizedek priesthood and set apart as the president of the church in Canada. And we know that he will have a beautiful time in church leadership. The converts from this church, I told you that. Then this is the last part of Elder Kimball's blessing to Parley P. Pratt. And from the things growing out of this mission shall the fullness of the gospel spread into England and cause a great work to be done in that land. This is a magnificent and fascinating blessing that this apostle gives to his fellow quorum mate. And I think a couple of things is what I want to observe from this. Number one, the significance of priesthood blessings in our lives. I don't know that we receive as many priesthood blessings as we ought to. I think we get casual with it. And I just say, if it's been a while since you've had a priesthood blessing, call on the Melchizedek priesthood holders in your life and ask for a blessing. For those of us blessing, I think, this is just my opinion, but sometimes we get a little chicken. We get a little chicken, so we give people the blessing, take your medicine and listen to your doctor, amen. You know. That's not Heber C. Kimball. He felt things in his heart and he said them out, and I gotta imagine that the minute he said them out, he thought, That's crazy talk. Thankful is never going to have a baby. She's frail. This is crazy talk. How is this going to take the gospel to England? There's only a couple thousand of us, and we're in the middle of an apostasy in Kirtland, and the economy is blowing up. And Heber C. Kimball makes these blessings. And then Parley P. Pratt, this is the next line of it. Parley P. Pratt lives his life as if the blessing were true. Sometimes I think when spiritual experiences or prophecy happens to us, we live our life as if it's not true and hope that there will be evidence along the way. Do you know what I mean? Our scientific rationalism, our mind has been trained to doubt things. And so we receive a blessing and then we want to see the proof of the blessing before we take the next step into the darkness. And I don't think that's the way our faith works, and that's certainly not the way Elder Pratt and Sister Pratt took this prophecy. They moved forward with that idea that what Elder Kimball had prophesied was true and would surely be fulfilled. The end. So Parley goes up on his mission, baptizing a lot of people. Meanwhile, in July of 37, so a couple months later, Parley's up in Canada. They're in a meeting in the Kirtland Temple. Joseph and Heber are sitting in the pulpits. They're the speakers to this meeting. And Joseph leans over to Heber and just whispers, "Brother Heber, the Spirit of the Lord has whispered to me. Let my servant Heber go to England and proclaim my gospel and open the door of salvation to that nation." Boom. You know, can you imagine? First of all, does anybody know about Elder Kimball's background? would look at them and we would say, oh yeah, he can do that. He's been running a multi-billion dollar company before he was called. Oh yeah, he can do that. He's got a law degree from Duke and was an assistant justice. Oh, he can do that, right? Thus, our faith gets a little constrained. Because we look, and man, every time I'm in a class and somebody wants to talk about President Nelson and they start going through his biography and this checklist as if that's what makes him God's mouthpiece, you know? And there's part of us, except for the 99 bit that surprises everybody, but his resume qualifies him to run this corporation, the corporation of the President of the Church of Jesus Christ, right? He's got the merit badges to be a corporation director, a CEO. That's not why he's doing it. That's what I love about Heber C. Kimball's mission. Heber C. Kimball was the guy in the Quorum of the Twelve that makes Brigham Young look like a Harvard-educated guy. I invite you to look at his journal, to search for his letters to his back and forth to his wife. Sometimes he spells words in such a way that you can't even sound them out. And you think, what is he thinking? Why is there a seven in there? But he had a pure heart, and obviously he had an open spirit to hear the voice of the Lord in his life. But when Joseph gives him that calling, he says, the idea of being appointed to such an important mission was almost more than I could bear up under. I truly felt my weakness and unworthiness. However, that's a word I love to circle in things I'm reading, the howevers and the buts and the wherefores. I don't feel qualified, I don't feel smart enough, and I don't feel worthy enough. But all these considerations did not deter me from the path of duty. But the moment I understood the will of my Heavenly Father, I felt determined to go at all hazards. He just got that kind of soul, and I love him for that. But meanwhile, Parley has come back, thankful delivered their boy, and then she passed away. Parley's emotionally wrecked. He comes back to Kirtland and is broke and has bought property. I'm sorry. I yelled a lot last night at the young adult event, it was just a devotional. I don't know why I was screaming. But Elder Pratt has speculated on property with the Kirtland Safety Society. Speculating on property is always a dangerous thing, right? He borrowed money to buy property with the expectation he would sell it for more than he bought it for. And then the bottom falls out of the Jackson economy, and Parley's left holding this property, which he bought knowing that Joseph Smith backed the Kirtland Safety Society. And so Elder Pratt's first thought is, darn you, Joseph, you got me into this mess. That's... Every time I hope is the angels calling me home. So Parley starts into the path of apostasy, the same as those other brethren, John Boynton, Luke and Lyman Johnson, William McClellan, some of those other apostles who have become hostile, who had, you know, sword fights in the temple like we talked about last week. Parley is in that position. When John Taylor brings the Canadian saints to Kirtland, and John Taylor goes to his missionary, his elder, and says, if Joseph Smith was a prophet, if Joseph Smith was then a prophet, he is now a prophet. That causes Parley moments of repentance, and he went to Brother Joseph in tears and broken heart and contrite spirit. confessed wherein I had erred in spirit, murmured or done so, said amiss. He frankly forgave me, prayed for me, and blessed me. Let me take a drink of water while you look at Elder Pratt's story of his repentance, and then I want you to tell me three things out of this. Three things you notice from this statement from Elder Pratt about repentance and forgiveness that can be applied to our daily lives and bless us.
I think he went forward in extreme humility, which is hard. And it's hard to go to your leaders with those feelings that he must have had, and they must have been pretty strong for him to take care of it right then.
He had written an open letter to Joseph Smith, calling him out, calling Joseph Smith to repentance. So Party thought he had the high ground on this. So for him to humble himself, now I'm grateful you brought that one up, because that 100% is one of the first items on daily repentance, isn't it? If we're going to learn how to repent daily, we've got to learn how to humble ourselves and have a broken heart and a contrite spirit, so that we can admit that we are not perfect. So we can admit that yesterday wasn't as good as it should have been. And so often we're afraid of that. Thank you. He humbled himself in a contrite spirit. I challenge you for three. Who's got it, number two?
I love it says that Joseph frankly forgave me. It's a good example for us. So often I want to make sure that everybody knows why I was right, and it looks like Joseph didn't point stuff out and say, so I was right, right? The Lord was with me, right?
You're going to write another letter? Why don't you write another letter?
Right? Right. I love that idea of just dropping it.
I hope that some of us in here remember President Hunter's Christmas message, the one he gave as president of the church, but look it up. In it, President Hunter talks about making Christmas season a special thing, and he says, you know, write a letter to a friend or play with a puppy or be nice to a child. Just gives kind of this prescription, and one of them is forgive somebody who has wronged you. You know who they are, and you know why they've wronged you, and you probably know why you are right, which is why them wronging you is such a horrible thing. I invite you to frankly forgive them.
I'm telling you, that's dang hard.
Isn't it?
So we have this developer who shall be unnamed at this point, and he built the decks off the new houses, condos, so they hang out into my front yard. They're not over the property line, but you open your kitchen door, or if I go out in my skivvies to let my dog out, everybody can see. I told him off. Okay, it's just been the last week I've been able to say, Heavenly Father, please bless so-and-so, because I can't be kind right now. It almost gave me a nervous breakdown. It is hard to do. It's hard to forgive, and it's hard to let go when I go out my front door and those things are right there every time. That is my new challenge. So I need to go to the temple. I have to forgive him, and I have to get a grip on myself. And I'm the most immature person I know. I don't see that happening. You know? I'm being serious. Stop laughing at me.
I'm laughing with love.
We do recognize.
So hard. It can be so hard. Miss Dawn, she was just by herself in a field for years and years, and then all of a sudden there's just people right there.
On all sides.
But there's just things in life that are just so, so hard that we can say just easy to forgive. Or not easy. We can say forgive, but it's not easy.
Right.
It's not. I mean, that's why it's a gift. I mean, only the Lord has to give that gift sometimes, because we, our human bodies, don't want to do it.
I'm glad you pointed that out. This Joseph's forgiveness isn't because Joseph has such a high character. Joseph's forgiveness is because the power of the Lord moves through him. Right? I think that was a great statement.
Well, the third thing I took away from this is Joseph didn't just say, okay, I forgive you, but he prayed for him and blessed him. I mean, he went that extra mile to show the love and the true forgiveness that he had for him.
Right there on the spot.
And I don't think it can always happen right then and there, though. I think some things take more time.
I do want to emphasize, this is not Joseph. This is the power of God flowing through Joseph. He was not always one to be quick to forgive, we know, right? We know he could get angry when he's crossed. But right here, I think because the Lord Jesus Christ forgives party people at, that power of the Lord moved through Joseph. And granted, he was a valid conduit, right? But when we need to forgive, it's not just, I want to say, it's not just muster the willpower within yourself. It is find that channel from God and let that be the thing that flows through you. Anyway, good conversation. Next issue. So, Elder Kimball is assigned to take the following. Elder Orson Hyde has been in a bad mood about the apostasy in Kirtland, but when he hears of a great opportunity to serve a mission, he bounces right back. Okay, I'm back in. He'll do that a couple of times. Bless him, President Elder Hyde. Willard Richards is 32-year-old bachelor, Brigham Young's cousin. He's a physician. He got his degree by mail order. And he was a botanical physician, so he would prescribe plants to people. But I don't know. He had also done a residency in a surgery, so he knew how to cut into people. But also some Canadian converts: John Snyder, Joseph Fielding, Isaac Russell, and John Goodson, all became part of this. So Elder Kimball's prophecy is exactly fulfilled, right? Because of Party's mission in Canada, these men were converted, and they go to England with Elder Kimball. They are all, three of the four of them are immigrants from different places in England. And so when they jump in the boat and they head over to Liverpool, and because I made so many jokes about American football, I only thought I should do a tiny shout out to Liverpool. I don't know if they're good. I don't really care. Soccer. Soccer's like football for people who can't catch.
Oh.
They're in Liverpool a few days, and then Joseph Fielding says, my brother is a minister in Preston. So they head inland to Preston, England, and completely industrial. Every image you can create in your Dickens mind about smokestacks and little orphans asking for another little bit of porridge. Just England at that time. And there is a Preston football team. But they arrive, and there's an election going on. This picture is from the pageant that they would run there in Preston. I think it probably got suspended with all the other pageants. But when they get there, there is a election banner flying out of the window of a multi-story building that says "Truth Will Prevail." And Heber C. Kimball is the guy that everything's assigned to him. So even though that was an election sign, he took it personally. He said, "Amen. Let's go let truth prevail." In his second mission to England, I was going to save this, tell you later, but I'll tell you twice, like I do with 100 things. But in his second mission to England, he's in London, and young Queen Victoria comes by in a procession, and as everybody comes by, Heber C. Kimball bows his head and says, "God bless you," which, you know, that's what everybody would say. But Elder Kimball took it that he had given Queen Victoria an apostolic blessing, which is why she, you know, had such a long and productive reign, unless you're from India. Or so if you ever want to go on a tour, give me a call. I've never been there, but I have mapped it from space. So this is where the river is. This is where the first baptisms took place, and this is where they stayed. And this is where they preached their sermons. But they go to Brother Fielding's brother, and he's the minister here in Vauxhall Chapel, where he's teaching. They ask if they can have permission to teach, and he gives it to them, and they go in and teach such a great sermon that very moment, 9 people decide they want to be baptized. And they'd been of a religious tradition that had not followed with the ordinance of baptism, because they'd kind of followed this grace line of thinking. The idea of thinking, if God is saving everybody by grace and not of works, then why would you ever need to be baptized? But these missionaries are so good that Brother Fielding, Pastor Fielding, says, "Kimball bored the holes, Goodson drove the nail, and Hyde clinched them." You get the carpentry metaphor that by the time Elder Hyde gets done speaking, they're hooked. They have felt the Spirit. They know the gospel message, they understand it, and James does write to his brother after this, "With regard to your robbing me of my flock." what does robbing me of my flock mean to a Protestant pastor? So Joseph has gone into his brother James and destroyed his job. Sometimes we say, "Hooray, those missionaries, they baptized so many people." Yes, hooray. But there was a personal cost. James doesn't join. He does say, I do not believe at all that you were sent of God to rend my little church to pieces. Were I to speak as plain as you do, I should boldly declare that it was not God, but Satan, as an angel of light, sent you here.
To me, it was interesting that he let them come and preach there. But that was interesting. And to me, it sounded like he was kind of open to it until maybe he was going to lose his job. I don't know. Just he let them come.
There is an aspect that makes us different than Protestants. To a Protestant, you can be Presbyterian-y and have a Methodist-y person and a Baptist-y person get together and hire a preacher and be the church of Vauxhall, right? It doesn't, you know, we agree with this line of thought. We're not 100% Calvin, we're not 100% Wesley, kind of this. So inviting another preacher in only kind of lays another level of gospel truth, right? Latter-day Saints, on the other hand, we go in and we say, we invite you to change. We invite you not to be a member of that congregation, but to be a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And that's why he invited them in, because he wanted to take a break. He wanted a weekend without giving a sermon. The side effect was conversion.
Part of the problem for that is those preachers that invite the missionaries to teach, they just all of a sudden lose their livelihood. And if they aren't trained in anything else, then they have no way to feed their family because they're supported by their congregants.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so now this poor preacher, he doesn't join the church, even if he does, he's lost his congregation, he doesn't have a job.
Right.
And I bet his wife's beating him with her shoe, you know?
When we think about that, that's one of the things that makes me so fascinated by someone like Sidney Rigdon, who is a successful preacher in Kirtland, Ohio. Remember in Mentor and the Campbellites? And he's got these massive congregations, and Sidney throws it all away. And as a side effect, gets to run a tannery. They give him a job in the Kirtland economy, tanning hides. I don't know that he had any experience with that, but it certainly is not the same job as preparing a sermon every week. John Taylor, who leaves his faith as a Methodist preacher. John Young, Brigham's brother. There are those in our story who leave their livelihood. And I'm glad you recognize that. And I'm glad our hearts beat in a little bit of sympathy for James. I wish he would join the church. Things would have worked out better. But Joseph writes, I am now a stranger in my native land and almost to my father's house. I'm something like Joseph when sold by his brethren. The devil would suggest perhaps I am wrong, but it cannot be. I have too much evidence of truth to give way to such a thought. May the Lord help me stand fast in the liberty of the gospel of my calling. When we make the list in a modern sense of the things that cause us a faith crisis, those moments where we hear something that we hadn't known before and it rubs us wrong, the moment when some bishop is mean to us, or you know, some developer builds condos next to our house. Not my job, I'm not a bishop. But we all have those things that make us think, maybe what I've been doing is not of God. Our friends who are falling away from the church call that the cognitive dissonance and the confirmational bias. Because somebody tells them, no, that couldn't have been the spirit you felt. You just made yourself feel that. That's confirmation bias. And I have been there. I've been at the point in somebody's argument where they say, you didn't feel anything, you just mind made you think that. Because this religion isn't logical, this religion doesn't make sense. And you and I get to that moment where we have to be Joseph Fielding. We can't just say the gospel just rolls over me and I'm happy and content, because when we have that challenge to our faith, we've got to be strong enough to say, I have too much evidence. I'm not going to forget the way that I felt on such and such an occasion. I'm not going to forget what the Lord said to me on such and such occasion. I have had too many prayers answered for me to believe that this is all just make-believe in my head. I'm not giving up. So may the Lord help me stand fast. May the Lord help me stand fast. Dallas?
I believe it was Elder Holland that said, doubt your doubts before you doubt your faith. And I'm hearing that just all over.
That takes mental effort. Because doubt is easy thinking. True? With anything. Once you doubt, you don't have to think about the thing again. Doubt is easy. Belief is complicated. Belief requires conscious effort. Belief is walking up a hill. And may the Lord bless us that we can stand fast in the liberty of the gospel. A couple of weeks ago in my Writings of Paul class, we talked about the saints standing in liberty, and we just pondered, what kind of liberty do we have because of the gospel of Jesus Christ? What are we free from? Death and sin? Well, yes. But I'm also free from judging the world. Let that go. I don't have to be the judge of the world because I understand the gospel of Jesus Christ. not only can I let judging the world go, I can let judging myself go. Because I have been redeemed by the atonement of my Savior, as I have covenanted with Him. I'm not waiting for proof that He keeps His promises, right? So I'm free. I'm free from worrying whether I'm good enough. May I just please give you that antidote for you to stand fast in the liberty of the gospel and realize that this is true. We have been freed. The chains of judging, the chains of self-doubt, the chains of perpetual guilt syndrome have all been broken by Jesus Christ. So on July 30th, 1837, the night before, the 29th to the 30th, over that night, there in this house, which still exists, which is why Europe is so fascinating, isn't it? The oldest thing in Utah that's not a teepee or pile of rocks is like 100 years old, and we say, my goodness, how could you possibly live in that house? This house in England still exists. The Heber C. Kimball and his companions were on the upper floor, and Isaac Russell wakes Brother Kimball up and says, I feel uneasy. There is an evil spirit. So Elder Kimball begins to bless him. And while thus engaged, I was struck with great force by some invisible power and fell senseless on the floor as if I had been shot. And the first thing I recollected was that I was supported by Brothers Hyde and Russell, who were beseeching a throne of grace on my behalf. They then laid me on the bed, but my agony was so great that I could not endure, and I was obliged to get out and fell on my knees and began to pray. They then sat on the bed and could distinctly see the evil spirits who foamed and gnashed their teeth upon us. We gazed upon them about an hour and a half, and I shall never forget the horror and malignity depicted on the countenance of those foul spirits, and any attempt to paint the scene which presented itself, or portray the malice and the enmity depicted in their countenance would be vain. I perspired exceedingly, and my clothes were as wet as if I had been taken out of the river. I felt exquisite pain and was in the greatest distress for some time. Yet, by it, I learned the power of the adversary, his enmity against the servants of God, and got some understanding of the invisible world. I wouldn't wish that on a monkey on a rock, you know? That is horrible. And Elder Kimball comes out of it and says, grateful for the lesson. What an attitude. I saw kind of a self-help guru on the YouTube that recommended changing our vocabulary. Kind of instead of I have to start saying I get to start looking at our opportunities as gifts and what changes that makes in our overall attitude. Elder Kimball has, I can't even imagine how horrible that must have been, how frightening, terrifying, how physically painful. And at the end he says, man, I saw the invisible world. That was a gift. You know how many times we've talked about the invisible world from the light side, but when Heber gets back to America and talks to Joseph Smith, instead of Joseph saying, oh, there, Heber, what a good boy. Listen to what Joseph Smith says. Who will read this one for us, please? Somebody see that? Thank you, Father.
At that time, you were nigh unto the Lord. There was only a veil between you and him, but you could not see him. When I heard of it, it gave me great joy, for I then knew that the work of God had taken root in that land. It was this that caused the devil to make a struggle to kill you.
Made me very glad to hear that, Heber. Made me glad that you were having a horrible time. Because then I knew that the church was taking hold. And that's why the devil was trying to get you. What horrible things have been in your world that have come from the devil? What horrible things that have come that you don't know where they came from because you haven't been able to place the blame because you didn't see into the invisible world? But think of the horrible things that we endure. And this change of view, when we see into the invisible world and say, somebody's been monkeying with me. Likewise, if we can see into the invisible world to the dark side and recognize that it exists and recognize that it's horrible and that it affects our life, once we recognize that, it should be easy for us to turn around and say, there was only a thin veil between you and you could not see him. This is what I've said even just about the conversation of faith and doubt. It's just a matter of putting the shadow behind you and facing the sun. Takes deliberate effort, but recognize in those shadow moments, if you turn around, you will see the sun. And I believe that's true. On July 30th, they went down to the River Ribble, where they were going to hold these baptisms. And they didn't know who should be baptized first, so they decided to have a foot race. And George D. Watt became the first convert baptism in England. Because he won the race because he was young and fit, and a circumstance took place which I cannot refrain from mentioning, for it will show the eagerness and the anxiety of some in that land to obey the gospel. Two of the male candidates, when they changed their clothes at a distance of several rods from the place where I was standing in the water, were so anxious to obey the gospel that they ran with all their might to the water, each wishing to be baptized first. The younger, George D. Watt, being quicker of foot than the older, outran him and came first into the water. This good brother will wind up being the shorthand scribe for the Journal of Disc. Everything that was said in conferences in Salt Lake City for, you know, like 50 years, he wrote them down in his crazy form of shorthand. To my knowledge, there is only one person, one historian right now who can read it, who knows his version of shorthand. He also, under the instructions of President Young, he created the Deseret alphabet. Have you heard about that? A phonetic alphabet that President Young wanted to give to new converts so that they was easier for them to pronounce English words. But George E. Watt comes first. Then, Henry Clegg, who's in his 50s, bless him, but he gets to be the second, which, you know how deep I had to dig to find the man who he ran against? I offered this, I sometimes call this the Shiblon Doctrine. You know it, that Alma, when he's writing to his sons, writes several chapters to his all-star human. You are so great. And he writes in several chapters to his black sheep and says, oh, I wish you'd be smarter. And right there in the middle, he says to Shiblon, man, this tiny little chapter, this throwaway, have you ever felt Shiblon in your life? Have you ever wondered why you aren't getting picked for the kickball team? I love thinking about Henry Clegg just because he was just as baptized, his sins were just as remitted, and he's just as much a member of the church. Lynette, what were you thinking?
About Elder Bednar's talk.
Yeah.
And those that were no less serviceable in the Book of Mormon and then at the Last Wagon.
They were at the Last Wagon.
Super good people. They just don't have their name in the book.
They're just not going to be in the book, right? I love them. I had a phenomenal spiritual experience on this topic one time when I was taking a tour through the Salt Lake Cemetery, looking at the headstones of all the prophets and the apostles and the famouses, and I was standing across the street from Wilford Woodruff's headstone, and I just taught the group how great Wilford Woodruff was, and then I pointed to Rasta Snow, and then all of a sudden my soul was filled with an understanding of all those headstones. All those headstones that I'm not telling stories about them. Their posterity isn't even telling stories about them anymore, but they have lived lives, and I was just filled with gratitude for humanity. Sister Anne Elizabeth Walmsley had tuberculosis, and they thought she was on death's door. And Heber C. Kimball blessed her and told her if she would be baptized, she would be healed. And there is a picture of her as an old lady, and there is her headstone in Bear Lake. Anyway, that cemetery. So she becomes a pioneer. She comes to Utah. She goes to Idaho. She has a lot of kids and lives happily ever after. Then Elder Kimball goes to Walkerford, England, and goes to the church house of John Richards. There's his church. There's the school that is attached to it and his residence. And Heber becomes good friends with him. And then he baptizes a girl. He baptizes Janetta Richards. And after he baptizes her, he writes a letter to 32-year-old Willard Richards, who's heavier than most, who's gone bald, who is still single, but he's a doctor. That's a good catch. But Heber writes him, I baptized your daughter, or your wife today. Willard is down in Manchester, where he's having great success. Among his converts are William Clayton, who will write Come Come Ye Saints and be a great hero of the Restoration. Brigham Young on Heber C. Kimball. Brigham Young once described the warm, comfortable way Kimball put people at ease so he could teach them. Come, my friend, sit down. Do not be in a hurry. And he would begin to preach the gospel in a plain, familiar manner and make his hearers believe everything he said. Make them testify of his truth, whether they believed it or not, asking, now ain't that so? And they would say yes, and he would make scripture as he needed. He would make scripture as he needed, I love that, out of his own Bible and ask, now ain't that so? And the reply would be yes. He would say, now you believe this? You see how plain the gospel is? Come along now. And he would lead them into the waters of baptism. The people would want to come and see him early in the morning, stay with him until noon, and from that until night, and he would put his arm around their necks and say, come, let's go down into the water. Here's a similar thing. I think a lot of us fear the idea of missionary work because it looks so hard to us. Instead of turning around and facing the sun, the missionary work is just an expression of our Mormonism, an expression of what we do. We don't have to make a program. We had a general authority one time visit our stake, and the first counselor in the stake presidency and I explained to him the great program we had created for our elders, corps presidents, and our high priest group leaders, that we had created this great program of reporting and it was magnificent. It involved several pages of, brain mapping. And he said to us, I bear my testimony that will not work. Boom. Nothing will work unless you are ministering to the people. Come now. Ain't that so? People in your life that you've been blessed to minister to, family members or neighbors, can we just be a little more Heber C. Kimball? They're not all going to change. They're not all going to accept the gospel, but let's be at ease. Come now, my friend. Sit down. Do not be in a hurry. Let's chat a bit. By Christmas, so they got there in July. By December 25th, 1837, nearly 300 converts attended the first conference of the church in England. That's in Preston. Meanwhile, Manchester is growing even faster. Heber C. Kimball goes upstream a little bit to Downham and Chatburn, and he teaches there for a little while. When it's time for him to leave and head back to the States, the next morning the village were all in tears, thinking they should see my face no more. When I left them, my feelings were such as I cannot describe. As I walked down the street, followed by numbers, the doors were crowded by the inmates of the house to bid us a last farewell. who could only give vent to their grief in sobs and broken accounts and broken accents. While contemplating this scene, we were induced to take off our hats, for we felt as if the place was holy ground. The Spirit of the Lord rested down upon us, and I was constrained to bless the whole region of country. We were followed by a great number, a considerable distance from the village, who could hardly then separate themselves for us. My heart was like unto theirs, and I thought my head was a fountain of tears, for I wept for several miles after I bid them adieu. Number one, most returned missionaries know that feeling. That feeling of saying goodbye to a district or a zone or a town. Number two, everybody coming out of those houses were not members of the church. They could not have been, right? He didn't baptize the whole town. But what did he do? He befriended the whole town. So that the Methodists were sad to see him go. And the Anglicans were sad to see him go. Number three, he felt as if he were standing on holy ground. He gets back and Joseph says, "Yeah, you're standing on holy ground, all right, Heber. The reason you felt as you did in the streets of Chapron was because the place was indeed holy ground. Some of the ancient prophets had traveled in that region and dedicated the land, and that Heber had reaped the benefit of their blessing." Well, I would like more information on that, Joseph. B, how many times have you reaped the benefit of somebody else's blessing? You just live in your life and some blessing comes into your life and you just can't think of anybody but some Welsh blacksmith standing out by his forge and loving the gospel, and you think, "Thanks, John. Appreciate what you did because I feel like I just got a blessing from you." Now, if that's true, what great, great, great grandchild yet to be thought about is going to reap a blessing from the righteousness that you leave. Now, there are theories that Joseph of Arimathea went to England. You remember Joseph of Arimathea? He is the Pharisee who claimed the body of Jesus and buried it in his tomb. Some say he was Jesus' uncle. That's just an opinion. But his daughter Anne married the Welsh king Belimaur, who had from Joseph of Arimathea the Holy Grail, which that's a carpenter's cup. You've chosen wisely. And their descendant is Queen Victoria. That was the theory. The theory that was created in the 1840s. So Joseph Smith said this in the 30s, and somebody completely, but if it's 1840s, you're just making up genealogy at that point, right?
The patron saint of Scotland is Saint Andrew, because there's a legend that he reached Scotland.
Right?
Anyway, it's a legend, but you know.
Right, that Andrew, the brother of Peter,
right,
made it to Scotland. And there's also tradition of the missing chapter of Acts, because Acts just seems to end, doesn't it? You're reading along, it's a nice story, Paul's in jail, and all of a sudden, Romans. Oh. But what if that last chapter, somebody made it up, what the last chapter, Paul went to England, and his descendant was Boudica, the fierce warrior queen. Of course, that's got to be true. Paul had such great missionary success there that we've never heard, because he taught the Druids, who proved to him that they were actually Jewish. The lesson, though, I would say, by April 1838, over 1,600 had been baptized and organized into more than 20 branches throughout the country. Why did so many people join the church in England? It was post-industrial England. They were sad and looking for hope. Elder Kimball and Hyde were excellent teachers. People joined the church because of the Holy Ghost, because of the influence of Jesus Christ from the other side of the veil. When we stop saying they did it because they So every time we say that, we say the reason why my neighbor hasn't been baptized is because I'm a bad missionary. Take that off the page. It has nothing to do with the missionary. It just has to do with the Holy Ghost. Now, there are things we might do that might invite the Holy Ghost, and there are things that we do that offend him. But also, it's not because you're good or bad. It's just because you're you. And you went living your life as a disciple of Christ. And at points in your life, Heavenly Father put people in your way for you to love, to appreciate, to minister to put your arm around and say, now ain't that so. This happens to you guys all the time. I promise. Oh, yes, Beth.
And I think the Holy Ghost starts to work well before the missionaries were there. He was preparing their hearts. These are people that were prepared.
I believe that. Right now, people say, well, the church is growing like crazy in Africa and in Latin America, and it's we're completely changing the nature of the church because of all these foreigners. They're getting baptized because Africa is so desperate. No. They're getting baptized because the Holy Ghost is moving upon that continent. The Holy Ghost is moving in Eastern Europe. The Holy Ghost is moving in Corinth. The Holy Ghost moves people toward the gospel. He prepares them, and then bears testimony. Well, you've got your arm around their shoulder. I witness that in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Pray.
Our kind eternal Father in heaven, we come before thee at the close of our class and express our love and gratitude unto thee for the brave early members of the church who sacrificed all so that we might have the gospel. We are grateful, Heavenly Father, to know of them and feel of their spirits, and pray that thou would help us to be more like them in our modern age, to love our neighbors and those even that we don't minister to. Help us to be more kind. Help us that we can take this message that Brother Reese has taught today about the Holy Ghost, that we will have more faith, less fear, more courage. And we ask this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Bless you for that prayer. Thank you. Have a great week, everybody.